Welcome to Judah's Roar Domestic Violence Awareness Initiative YouTube channel. I'm your host, Apostle Cheryl L. Richardson. Today's topic is going to be, why does a victim leave? Why does a victim leave? Now, before we get started, I'm going to give you a few seconds. Check down here, click on that subscribe button if you've not done so already. Feel free to share this video even as you are viewing it. Yes, you can share it while you're watching it, all right? And feel free to comment and like as well. Today's topic, why does a victim leave? We often hear questions asked regarding why does a victim stay? Or why doesn't a victim leave? Today, we're going to look at why does a victim leave? Okay. It's important to gain an understanding regarding those things that go into a victim, summoning the courage, because that's what it takes to actually exit an abusive relationship. It takes a lot. It takes a lot, all right? And so the first thing that we want to look at is this. If a victim is ready to leave, is contemplating leaving, it's gone beyond just a thought process, and it has become something that they have resolved to do. This means that the victim, whether they are male or female, because we recognize that men can be victims as well, that they have progressed to a place in their thought process, the victim has, that they can acknowledge that they've made a series of errors in either entering a relationship with an abusive person or remaining in a relationship once it became clear that the relationship was a toxic, unhealthy, unsafe relationship. And so the victim has to first bring themselves to a place where they can accept that they've made this grave error. And they have to move past the point where they're just simply blaming themselves for it, where they accept that the relationship is what it is, right? And that they are powerless to change it. They are powerless to change it. And so this may take an extended period of time. And so although we know that there are similarities in domestic violence relationships, right? Each relationship is unique to that victim and to that abuser. And so there are many similarities. And this is why we can't compare one relationship to another, even in terms of determining, is it time for me to exit this situation? All right. And so point number one, the victim has progressed to a place in his or her thinking that they are now able to acknowledge that they've made a serious error in judgment in entering into a relationship with this person and remaining in a relationship with this person. All right. The second thing that has to happen is this for a victim to leave. He or she can no longer make excuses for the abuser's behavior that calm their anxieties or calm their fears. They're no longer able to say, well, they had a rough childhood. Well, they had a bad day. Oh, they have a substance abuse issue. Oh, they have mental health concerns. They've reached a place where they can acknowledge that these things may have occurred in the life of the abuser, but they are no longer an adequate reason for the victim to be brutalized emotionally or physically, okay? Thing number three, the victim has heard of resources via social media, right? Maybe they've come across Judah's Roar Domestic Violence Awareness Initiative YouTube channel. Maybe they've come across some other resources that are out there on YouTube or on Facebook or on Instagram. Maybe because of friends or loved ones, maybe their spiritual advisor, their pastor, their apostle, someone has said something. Maybe they've seen something on television or heard something on the radio, all right? Maybe the local domestic violence shelter has made resources available and they've seen a flyer or they've seen a pamphlet. Maybe they've reached out to the domestic violence hotline or maybe they're involved in a support group on social media. We have a faith-based group, a private group on Facebook, and it's called Dominion Over Domestic Violence. Maybe they've heard about that, but they've heard something from outside of the relationship that drives home the fact that the situation that they're in is untenable, that it is toxic, that it is unsafe, and that their life may very well be in danger. And so now, so far, we've talked about three things. The victim has progressed to a place in their thought process where they acknowledge that they've made a mistake in entering this relationship or staying in this relationship once the red flag started going off, right? The second thing that we've talked about is that he or she can no longer make excuses for the abuser's behavior that calms that anxiety and those fears, right? That there's no reason that they can come up with anymore that makes them feel better or hopeful about staying. And then the third thing is that maybe the victim has heard something by way of a resource outside of the relationship. It could be a loved one. It could be that you said something to them that caused them to understand that they don't deserve to be mistreated, or that their life or their mental health, their emotional health, their spiritual well-being is literally in jeopardy while they are in that relationship, right? Because one of the underpinnings of a domestic violence riddled relationship is isolation. It's isolation. And so if a resource is able to reach them where they are as they go about their day-to-day life, oftentimes this can give a victim just enough hope and just enough support that they believe that they can move forward. Let's go on to the fourth thing. Maybe the victim hears the stories of other victims. They hear the stories and the testimonies and the journeys of others who have left abusive relationships. This encourages the victim to grab a hold to the belief that it's possible for them also, that it is possible, that there is life on the other side of abuse. And this is why it's so important that stories are shared so that victims can have hope. And it's important that the stories that are shared are not sanitized or have fairy dust sprinkled over them, right? That they understand that it was hard, that it was a tough decision, that it was painful, but there is life on the other side of it. So the fourth thing is hearing the stories of other victims. Hearing the stories of other victims in various stages of their journey to rebuild their lives and to reclaim their voice. Because what are we talking about? We're talking about the fact that if a victim can have hope that things can be better, that they can have a good life, that they do have value, that they do matter. It makes all the difference in the world. Hope is defined as the feeling that what is wanted can be had, or that events will turn out for the best. That even in exiting this relationship, even though you've been damaged, even though you've been traumatized, that you can rebuild. That's what hope is. That's what hope is. And this is why it's so important not to isolate. Now, what's another word for hope? Here are some other words for hope: aspiration, expectancy, longing, anticipation, faith, right? Belief, confidence, desire, and optimism. What does the Bible say about hope? Proverbs 13 and 12 says that hope deferred maketh the heart sick, but when the desire cometh, it is a tree of life. Hope deferred makes the heart sick. It's King James Version. But when the desire cometh, right, when things turn around, when we can take hold of hope, it is a tree of life. The Message Bible translates Proverbs 13 and 12 this way: unrelenting disappointment leaves you heartsick, but a sudden good break can turn life around. Unrelenting disappointment. Is that not what domestic violence is? When your relationship is on that track, is it not unrelenting disappointment? Okay. And so the Message Bible translation says, Proverbs 13 and 12, unrelenting disappointment leaves you heartsick, but a sudden good break can turn life around. I love that translation. I love it. In Proverbs 13 and 9, Solomon said, a longing fulfilled is sweet to the soul. A longing fulfilled is sweet to the soul. Now, I know that's right. I'm a living witness. All right. Thing number five, we're still talking about why a victim leaves. Not why they stay. Why do they leave? When they finally leave, why do they leave? Number five, the abuser has begun to directly abuse their children. The abuser has begun to directly abuse their children. Their children. And so for many, many parents, especially mothers, and this applies to committed fathers as well. They can justify and rationalize and misappropriate scripture and grab a hold to some cliches and slogans on bumper stickers to justify staying in a relationship that is harmful to them. But when it transcends them and it's clear that the children are being impacted, oftentimes that's the straw that broke the camel's back. That is the catalyst for the actual exiting of the relationship. Now, it's important to understand, as an aside, that even if you don't see your children acting out, you don't see any noticeable behaviors, that they are being impacted. It is not possible for children to live in a relationship in which domestic violence is taking place, even if it has not escalated to a place of physical aggression, and not be affected. They are 100% of the time impacted somehow negatively by being exposed to domestic violence, okay? You can search our YouTube channel right here for some videos specific to how domestic violence impacts children. Okay, thing number six, the victim recognizes that the violence has escalated. They're seeing a progression in the violence. First it was verbal abuse and emotional abuse, which is really horrible, right? And then it escalated to a little push here, a little shove there. Then an open hand slap. Then maybe a closed fist, right? Maybe sexual assault has begun to transpire and take place. Maybe they've experienced strangulation. Okay, people like to call it choking, but it's strangulation is what it is. Choking. It's when you bite an apple, you have a piece of candy and it gets lodged in your throat, right? Strangulation is the intentional impeding of another's windpipe, okay? Strangulation, it's as harsh as it sounds. We have a video about that too. So the victim recognizes that the violence has escalated, and the victim now believes that the next episode of violence, whatever that looks like in that household, whatever that looks like in that relationship, the victim now believes that the next episode could very well be fatal. They've come to understand that this abuser is completely capable of killing them. Okay. Number seven, the children are beginning to act out at home or in school, right? They may be bullying peers. They may be the problem child in the classroom. They may be bullying their siblings, getting into fights in the community, disrespecting teachers or other authority figures, all right? Here's a real key way that you can tell. They may become withdrawn and sullen. You know, a child who is naturally outgoing and charismatic and engaging may be withdrawn and sullen or irritable. They may present as angry often. they may become more anxious and nervous and unsure of themselves and tentative as they move through their day. They may begin to engage in self-harming behaviors, and they may be depressed. Their sleep pattern may be completely disrupted. Maybe they want to sleep all of the time and not socialize with other children, or maybe they struggle to sleep, or they have difficulty falling asleep, or they fall asleep and they wake frequently. And so you may notice these changes in the children's behavior. Another key thing is that the child or children may very well become blatantly disrespectful and challenging and demanding towards the victim. Okay. Another thing that you may see happen is that the child becomes defiant with the victim, challenging, almost treating them the way the abuser does. Or you may have a child who confronts the abuser, becomes defiant towards the abuser, and very protective of the parent or guardian who they perceive to be the victim, okay? And so it's important. And this typically is what begins to get the attention of the victim, because this is more important to them. The impact on their children is oftentimes more important to them than whatever they may be absorbing in the form of abuse. And so the victim recognizes, when they see these behaviors that I've just talked about, that they must remove their children from this situation. And that can be a catalyst for them leaving the relationship. Okay, so what we've been talking about? We have been talking about why a victim leaves. We've identified 7 reasons, and there are more. We wanted to make sure that we focused on those 7. So we've talked about 7 reasons that a victim ultimately arrives at the decision to leave. And what those things might be that convince them that they must exit an abusive relationship. And this can be the case even if it has not escalated to physical violence, all right? So in summary, ultimately, a victim leaves when their own core values, you know, the premise that governs their life and determines right and wrong for them. We each have a set of core values. And we may have some similar values, but each of us have core values by which we pretty much live our lives. Our core values determine what we view as right and wrong. And so in a victim's life, when their own core values, those things that determine for them in their life what is right and wrong for them, when their core values are so egregiously, horribly breached that they can no longer rationalize, right? They can no longer make excuses for it, all right? For example, a loved one is harmed, or there's threatened harm to a loved one. There's threatened harm of a pet. There's threatened harm of coworkers. Or someone who is a dear friend, or someone who you barely know, but who the abuser views as a threat, all right? When the victim's core values are breached enough that they can no longer make excuses, they can no longer find a scripture to make it okay, they can no longer find anything in a sacred text that justifies how they're being treated, that's when they determine that they have to go, that they need to go, okay? Oftentimes though, beloved, due to trauma bonding, the harm that the victim alone has suffered is not enough. It's not unusual for the damage that a victim has endured over time, whether it be a short period of time or an extended period of time. It can be days, it can be weeks, it can be months, it can be decades. Often, due to trauma bonding, the the harm that the victim has suffered and endured themselves is not enough to serve as a catalyst for them to leave, okay? It's when those core values, those things that they hold dear, those things that they know, no matter what, are right and wrong, when those things are violated, oftentimes that's when a victim can break free. So I have a question for you. Are you doing all that you can to stop domestic violence? Are you doing all that you can? For ways on how you can partner with us and support us in our quest to ignite hearts, inspire minds, and safeguard destinies, you can check the description box below. We appreciate so much you taking the time to view this video. We appreciate your taking the time to share and to comment and to like. There is life on the other side of abuse. And to anyone who is in a domestic violence relationship, reach out to the domestic violence hotline. There's information in our description box that will help you to understand how you can access some resources. Subscribe to our channel. View the videos anytime you want to. Feel free to share them on your social media platforms, okay? We want you to know that there is life on the other side, that hope deferred makes the heart sick, right? But when that desire comes, that desire for a better life, right? When that comes into view, it is a tree of life. For anyone planning to exit an abusive relationship, we wholeheartedly encourage you to develop a viable safety plan. Now, we have a blog that if you subscribe to it, then you will automatically be sent a template for a safety plan. No two safety plans are going to look exactly the same. My safety plan won't look like your safety plan, all right? But it's important that you have a safety plan. And for those of you who have not come to the conclusion that you need to leave that relationship, no matter how unhealthy it is, right? It's important that you have a safety plan as well. Feel free to reach out, inbox us if we can be of help to you. We have a faith-based group on Facebook called Dominion Over Domestic Violence. And we welcome those who want to encourage others as well as those who need to be encouraged right about now, right? You stay safe out there. Thanks for watching.